This is Innerview, an inside look at the people whose music has changed our lives. Tonight, Innerview is brought to you by Sertz Candy Breath Mints, Lee Jeans, the brand that fits, Doritos brand tortilla chips, and Budweiser. For all you do, this Bud's for you.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Jim Ladd. Tonight, I would like you to welcome a man who has played an integral part in today's heavy metal movement. Aside from creating the band that bears his name, he could easily be found kicking around the LA metal circuit, producing such bands as Black and Blue and Great White.
I'm come to take your love.
In the late 1970s, our guest and his band were getting absolutely nowhere in Los Angeles. But hearing that there was a market for metal overseas, packed up their instruments and headed for the club circuit in Germany. The tour proved successful, and upon return to LA, our guest was introduced to producer Dieter Dierks, who would later invite him back to Germany to record some background vocals for the Scorpions LP, Blackout. While back in Germany, our guest would put together a demo tape that managed to land him a European record deal. Needing a band, he called on old LA rivals George Lynch and Mick Brown from the band Exciter, and using Dieter's studio, recorded their first hit. Now, with the release of their second album, Tooth and Nail, it's definitely time to crank up the volume as we present an interview of Dokken.
The song, Tooth and Nail, this seems to talk about some of the struggles that this band has been through, this overnight sensation.
Oh, yeah, we've definitely been an overnight sensation.
Yeah. Tell me about some of the most memorable hard times that you had.
I wouldn't say they're bad memories, but experiences, I would say, like... you know, running out of gas in the Autobahn at 4 o'clock in the morning in East Germany, in a communist
East
country.
East Germany?
East Germany.
What were you doing in East Germany?
We were going through West Germany to get, you have to go through East Germany to get back into Berlin. And we played Berlin. And so we had to go through the communist side, which was makes you very appreciative of the American way, that's for sure. Seeing these big billboards with a fist crushing a plane with American signals on the wings. That was a little scary.
A little oppressive, huh?
I'm going, very interesting. And then it shows the next billboard of a red Chinese soldier, you know, patting a little kid on the head. And I think it's, you know, it's really pretty bad there.
Straight to the top.
We stopped in East Germany. We're not supposed to, but we did anyway, and stopped in little towns to see what was going on there. It's pretty repressed. 100 yards difference. You're driving through Germany. It's beautiful. The people are happy. You pick up to the checkpoint, Charlie, and we're all kidding with the guards. You know, hey, we're Dokken, and we're a rock band. We're going, you know, on a free record. Very stern looks in their face. Everybody looks very unhappy and miserable. You know, they're very, you drive over the border, you go through all this barbed wire and minefields and stuff like that. They search you, they take your passports. You get on the other side, and you notice when you're driving at night, nobody has their lights on. They turn it at 10 o'clock, there's no TV, they turn electricity off, you know, conserve energy and all this. And you listen to the radio, and all they talk about is how much wheat they harvested that day, you know what I mean? It's just like everybody go to bed, get up, and go back to the fields. And if you're rich, the only way to get rich in East Germany is to join the service. We saw a girl with a nice outfit on, a three-piece suit, and the road manager said that she must have a colonel or a major for her father, because she can afford those kind of clothes, which is like a $50 pair of clothes. But it's pretty repressive. It was kind of sad. We stopped, we had a bunch of candy with us, like chocolate bars and all the stuff we'd gotten, and people had given us. And I gave it to some kids in a store, and the mother came out and started yelling at me. And I said, why is she yelling at me? And she thought that I gave him the candy to look at. You know, like, see this candy bar? You know, just to tease him. And so my roadmaster explained they could have the candy, they can keep this stuff. And she started crying and stuff. And I thought, geez. I said, you know, because candy's a big thing. I mean, to see a Snickers bar was a big thing to them. It was kind of sad. This time I'm in, can't take no more.
When we come back, we'll see how old rivals function together when our interview of Dokken continues.
I'm Jim Ladd, and we're back now with our interview of Don Dokken. You know, inviting ex-rivals to join your band seems a little like asking for trouble. And it's also been written about pretty extensively in the trades that lead guitarist George Lynch and Don Dokken aren't exactly what you would call blood brothers.
George is a guitar player. I'm a guitar player. We both had our own bands for years. And then he ended up joining a band that he was the leader of and ended up with Dokken. And I'm eccentric, and I know I'm eccentric, and he's eccentric. So, we get along. I respect George a lot as a guitar player. I mean, the guy's incredible. He's a great guitar player. He's a great songwriter. So it's just a matter of, I would say it's friction. We get along fine. It's just in the beginning, they wrote about it, you know, the tension between George and I, because there was tension.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's fine now. It's like we've been on the road. We've done almost 100 concerts together in this last tour. 5 months of living together, you learn to accept each other's eccentricities, and so it's fine. You know, he likes blondes, and I mean, how could we get along fine? We share the same girls on the road. I mean, how could we not get along fine?
Did you get held up in a studio one
time? Mick and George did. I almost got their heads shot off.
What happened?
Well, Mick and George, when they were in the band Exciter, they were rehearsing down in Hollywood, and two guys just pulled up and decided they liked Mick's jacket. And we got out, and Mick was just staying there, and the guy whipped out a sawed-off shotgun, stuck up to Mick's head, and said, "Give me the jacket."
Wow.
So Mick's staying there with a shotgun to his head. They took their money and his jacket. And the guy kept saying, you know, "I'm going to blow you away, I'm going to blow you away, just give me a reason, I'm going to blow you away." And Mick said, "Okay, this is it, it's over. My career is now kaput." And the guys got in the car and split.
She ever catch the guys?
No, no history. Do they ever catch them?
No.
Somebody's watching me. Is it just a crazy dream? Is it my memory? Playing tricks on me. Out in the streets in the heat of the city. Just a fantasy. Is he coming back for more? Out in the alleyways, there is no second chance. Moving up behind you, you've lost the game at last. Don't close your eyes. Don't close your eyes, and I'll be there. Don't close your eyes. Don't close your eyes.
They were rehearsing. It was so sweaty in the rehearsal studio, they thought, I mean, this is on a boulevard.
Uh-huh.
With the streets lit up. They thought, let's go outside and get some air. And they walked out, and these guys just saw these long-haired rock and rollers standing there, and Mick had a leather jacket on, and the guy just decided he wanted that jacket. And he was willing to blow his head off for it. So Mick said, take my jacket, take my shoes, take whatever you want, you know. And I'm glad I wasn't there, because I probably would have got blown away, because that's the kind of person I am. Something inside me goes off when somebody tries to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And the funny thing was, there was cars were driving by, people were driving by, everybody saw what was going down, but, you know, I see nothing, I know nothing, and they people just kept going.
Somebody's watching me. Is it just a crazy dream? Is it my memory playing tricks on me?
Don't go away, because when we come back, we'll talk about Don Dokken's latest single with the Scorpions drummer, Herman the German Rarebell, right after these short messages. I'm Jim Ladd, and we're back now with the second half of our interview of Don Dokken.
Tell me about your association with the Scorpions.
Good guys, the Scorpions. Ah, let me tell you about the Scorpions. They are very nice people.
I thought so too when I met them. I was real impressed with them.
One of the few, well, I would say few, I don't know all the bands, but one of the few very famous bands that are very humble, very true to the music, no arrogance, they're not aloof. You can ask them anything you want. When they say something to you, it's straightforward, no beating around the bush.
We'll be right back.
I met the producer in Germany, in the Scorpions, and I used to kid around and like imitate Klaus Meyer, you know, that style of his singing. And so when I was in L.A., he called me up and we were doing a show. In fact, we were doing a show with Motley Crue at the Roxy.
Yeah.
Motley Crue wasn't signed yet. That's why we both ended up in the same record company. And he called me up and said, Klaus has had an operation on his voice, he's got problems, and I want you to come over and do the background vocals. I said, you want me to sing a Scorpions record? He's like the band that I idolize, right?
Yeah.
I listened to Scorpions when the Entrance albums way back when, and Lonesome Crow and all that. And so I flew to Germany and sang all the background vocals. And then Klaus came back in and redid some of them and kept some of mine. And I met them, and then we became very good friends with the drummer and the singer and all of them. I've got a solo album that's going to come out on Elektra with a drummer, Herman Rarebell. It's going to be an interesting album. It's going to be, nobody knows about this, so you'll be the first. So it's I'm singing lead vocals. You got Herman Rarebell on drums. You got Steve Marriott singing one of the songs.
You've really?
Got, yeah, Charlie Hoon singing one of the songs, who's in a band called Victory. There's a new version of Wipeout, heavy metal version of Wipeout. Should be great for the summer. Hey, if David Lee, you know, can do California Girls, we can do Wipeout, right? And it's going to be coming out. It was like a jam. All these singers got together with the drummer Scorpions and he wrote the songs, and we did this album. And it's a ballad called I'll Say Goodbye, and it's coming out next month.
Help my son, where will it go when I'm gone? I wish I knew. Is there a life, another life to come? Help my soul, don't you know life is... I have to know, so help me please before I've gone. I'll say goodbye. You know, I hear them calling, I've got to go. Help my soul, time goes too fast and seems so slow. I want to know, before I leave, who helped my soul. I'll say goodbye. Can't stay. I'll say goodbye and
Scorpions are really, they helped me a lot, you know, and I watched them in the studio, how they worked and how they got along and how they wrote songs, and that's why I decided I didn't want to be Don Dokken, solo artist extraordinaire. I wanted to be Dokken, the band, four guys writing collectively, and you know, that's, otherwise your songs get very narrow, I think. Uh-huh. It gets too narrow, and it's much wider when you have four different, you know, energies coming into one thing.
Especially if it's approached as a band situation.
Right, plus there's no animosity in a group. When you got a group where one guy controls the whole band, I would think there'd be a little animosity as far as creativity goes. I could never play in a group where somebody said, I'm gonna pay this much money and just play a guitar and sing this background vocal.
Yeah.
I'd rather starve and play bars and play what I wanted.
Yeah.
Because how do you get satisfaction out of being a hired gun?
We'll be back with the conclusion of our interview of Don Dokken right after this. I'm Jim Ladd, and we're back now with the conclusion of our interview of Don Dokken.
The song called Just Got Lucky, anybody who's ever been hurt in love can relate to this particular tune. Did this... we don't need names here, but did this come out of a personal experience?
That's George's baby there. Just Got Lucky was more of a George's song, but it's nothing. There's several songs in the Tupanel album that write about getting the boot.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I love it when, if anybody tells me that they've never been hurt before, I say they're lying. Because everyone's been hurt, everybody. You know, you can act as cold and callous as you want, but everyone's been hurt before, so why not write about it? Got Lucky is like joking. It's like, okay, you got the best of me, you did a number on me, and you got lucky. So, you know, so one brownie point for you.
Yeah.
That's what the song's all about. It's kind of like making fun of getting hurt a little bit.
Uh-huh.
As a song like Into the Fire, I tried to describe a person because I think that the person I describe, everyone's met that person at one time or another. That, you know, I say you leave your spell, and your lips say speak lies and misery. You know, we've all met those people.
Yeah.
There's always that person that they're smiling, and they're, but you just go, this person's going to do a number on me if I let them. And that's what you say. And you know it. You know they're going to do a number on you, but you let them get you anyway. That's what I meant by Into the Fire.
You leave your spell.
Let's talk about Breaking the Chains. That was, I liked that song a lot.
Me too.
Yeah. Where did that come from?
Breaking the Chains was the very first song that this current band, Dokken, ever wrote together.
Yeah, really?
That was a weird thing. I wrote the song Breaking the Chains, the music, da-da-da-da, you know, the groove. And when I auditioned Mick and George, I got this idea for a song. I said, what do you have for the material? I said, well, check this out, you know, and I played it, and I said, hey, nice groove. And actually, the song was called The Letter in the beginning. Uh-huh. Instead of going, breaking the chains around me, it was, my baby wrote me a letter. And I said, I think somebody did that.
Could have been, yeah.
Germany, Mick, the drummer, came up, I think, with the hook line, Breaking the Chains, and we wrote that song right in the studio. I mean, we did the music and wrote the lyrics. The song was finished, we didn't have any lyrics, so Mick and I wrote the lyrics, and George threw in some ideas, and I don't remember how it went down, it was so long ago, but I mean, we all sat down and wrote the lyrics together, and it was always, we knew it when we did the song. As soon as I sang the song, I said, this is it. And the thing about the song was, nobody heard the song. It was like the kind of song, you didn't hear it right away. But after you heard it a couple times, I like that song. It kind of grew on you, you know, like fungus.
Well, I hope you enjoyed this interview of Don Dokken, and be sure to tune in next week, same time and same frequency, for another interview. I'm Jim Lamb.